On to our next speaker, Dr. Manish Bapai, who is going to be dealing on posterior segment trauma. Dr. Manish, could you share your screen? He's a very versatile, amazing surgeon managing vitreoretina, uvea, neuroophthal, trauma, cataract, and LASIK. Clearly shows he's an individual of tremendous skill sets. So let's hear from him.
I think after these three talks, we can have the discussion, madam.
Yes, sure.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for opportunity, madam. I'll be talking about assessment of the posterior segment trauma. Just try to go to. Give me a second.
So just put it in presentation mode, sir.
Yeah.
On the bottom right.
I think this thing is not going down, so I'm not able to.
Just press F5.
F5.
Okay. Just stop and share again if you can.
Yeah, I'll stop and share again. Just give me. Just give me a minute.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Is it visible now?
Yes.
Good evening, everybody. I will be talking about assessment of posterior segment trauma. At the outset, I would like to thank ARC, thank Dr. Chitra Madam and Srinivas for giving me this opportunity. So when a patient with trauma comes to your clinic, there are certain things that we should be knowing. There are certain things that as postgraduates we should be knowing. The one is ocular trauma classification terminology as to what is an eyewall, which is sclera and cornea, closed globe injury where the eyewall is not breached, open globe injury where it is breached, whether it is rupture, which happens because of blunt trauma, severe blunt trauma, laceration, which is usually because of sharp object, which is a full thickness eyewall injury. Penetrating injury where there is a single laceration, while the perforating injury where there is a entrance and exit wound, and intraocular foreign body when there is a retained foreign object inside the eye. The more common trauma among the trauma is blunt ocular trauma, and easy way to remember the seven rings of blunt ocular trauma, which will give us a clue when we are when we are assessing these patients. There is pupillary sphincter tear, iridodialysis, angle recession, cyclodialysis cleft, trabecular meshwork tear, lens zonular dialysis, and retinal dialysis. So when we are seeing these patients, when we are evaluating these patients, we have to take the history, a detailed history, whether it's a penetrating or blunt trauma. We have to make sure that medico-legal consent forms are filled, whatever are relevant to your institute. The visual acuity has to be checked. That has to be the first thing to be checked and documented before you do anything. Even if the patient is bedridden, it has to be checked by sight. Slit lamp examination for any anterior segment damage which is there. Pupillary examination for RAPD to see whether there is any optic nerve injury. Applanation tension is obviously avoided in closed globe, while in open globe, while in closed globe, it should be checked. Fundus examination depends on media clarity, and I will come to that a little later. And the investigation, X-rays are not very commonly used. The CT scan is a preferred technique, and we'll come to again in detail about it. Ultrasound B-scan has been dealt in detail in earlier topics. So basically, I would like to show you about the surgical correlation of the assessment and investigation, so as to it will help us in understanding what to look for when we are seeing these patients. So Coming to fundus examination, if the media is clear, we have to look at, we can see the common presentations, that is Berlin's edema, choroidal tear. There might be a secondary CNVM. If it's a long-standing trauma, there might be a traumatic macular hole, or retinal dialysis with or without retinal detachment, and optic nerve, optic disc avulsion rarely. In cases of penetrating ocular trauma, rarely we might be able to see fundus if there is, there is an intraocular foreign body which has spared the lens. So Berlin's edema, it has, this is not an edema. This is transient whitening of the retina because following blunt trauma. It is usually associated with outer segment injury or of the photoreceptors, as we can see here in the OCT associated. Choroidal tear, again, if it is running through the fovea, as in this patient, we can see that there might be a significant vision loss, where in the OCT we can see the choroidal tear along with the subretinal hemorrhage in the subfoveal space here. This is a patient with old trauma about 6 months back who presented with vision loss, where we can see type 2 membrane treated with anti-VEGF. A traumatic macular hole might be seen here. Once it is treated with inverted flap technique, the macular hole is closed. OCT is an effective method of assessing these patients. This is another patient of traumatic macular hole where we can see the hole edges are lifted preoperatively and there are cystoid changes. There is no PVD as can be seen in this OCT, and intraoperatively, what does it mean? This is a younger patient. The patient doesn't have a PVD, so PVD has to be induced. This is aspiration scraper, which is used for induction of PVD. The PVD can be induced and then vitrectomy is completed. And then here the ventral limiting membrane peeling is done with inverted flap technique, where the inner ring of the ILM peeling is bunched onto the foveal area and then the peripheral ILM is peeled. This was a large foreign body. This is one of the rare things where we can see a large foreign body on X-ray, where and we can see this huge foreign body which was lying on the retinal surface, which had spared the lens. And intraoperatively, here we can see the foreign body is about 11 millimeters long, straight metallic rod, which is lying on the retinal surface. The vitrectomy is completed. One of the sclerotomies is enlarged. An intraocular magnet by Dr. Kun is used to railroad this large foreign body out of the eye. So assessing the foreign body, assessing this case, we have to plan our surgery as well. Here, as the foreign body is removed, the lens remains undamaged and patient has got good visual outcome. When there is the media are hazy and there is absence of fundus view, we need radiological investigation and CT scan is a preferred technique. We have to order axial and coronal scans with 1 to 2 millimeter sections or both investigations might be required in these patients. B scan ultrasound with vector A scan, and B scans are avoided in open globe injury. It is first better to close the globe and then in second stage do ultrasound. 10 or 20 megahertz probe might be used as discussed by previous speakers. And at looking at the extraocular, this is a large foreign body which is extraocular and intraconal. And when we are doing surgery, this is what we should expect. This is where the sclera is being closed. And then the medial rectus muscle is tagged and it is disinserted. And the foreign body can be seen lying exactly where it was seen in the CT scan. So assessing the CT scan preoperatively helps us in knowing what we are dealing with and what we have to expect intraoperatively. Here is a large foreign body. This is the next patient who is having a large foreign body with collapsed eyeball. And this is a large non-metallic foreign body in the eye. This was removed using the claw forceps that I happened to design. And this is intraoperatively after the sclera is closed and lensectomy is done. This is a large foreign body in the vitreous cavity.
The time is up.
So the vitrectomy, I'll just finish this video. So the vitrectomy is completed around the eye. The sclerotomy is enlarged and claw is used to pick up the foreign body. And then it is taken out of the eye through a large limbal section. We can see this is a large foreign body here. This was a patient with dislocated lens and perforating trauma. Here we can see this lens, and there is a lens which was seen in the previous ultrasound, and there is area of incarceration in the vitreous which can be seen. I'll skip through this video. And just to conclude, there is something called the ocular trauma score, which was proposed by Kuhn, which gives the raw points to, depending on presentation and final calculation. It helps in prognosticating the case. So to conclude, I think we have to do a detailed and meticulous examination of a severe ocular trauma. And it is used important in the aim of evaluation is to treatment planning, surgical planning and correlation, prognosis and counseling the patient. Thank you all for patient listening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Manish. That was a brilliant presentation. We would come back to you with questions after we hear the other two speakers.